Good afternoon, colleagues. We're just waiting for our moderator to join us, and then we'll start. Thank you. If you could just indulge in a little patience, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you all for your patience. I see our moderator has joined us. We will allow him to continue and start it for us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, colleagues. I don't know if I'm audible. This is Mpho Tsedu. I'm the facilitator for today's meeting. Sheriff, if you could just indicate if I'm audible enough.
Loud and clear, Mpho. From my side, we can hear you loud and clear. Thank you.
You are muted now. You are muted now, moderator.
Mpo, you're currently muted. So if you are talking, we're not hearing you, Mpo.
Colleagues, good afternoon. I don't know if I'm audible or not. Can somebody just indicate if I am audible? I'm just failing from my side to check.
You are audible. We can hear you, Mpo. You may start.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No, thanks, Sheriff. Thank you very much. And greetings to everybody. I can see we have quite a full house, at least 42 participants so far. As I said, my name is Mpo Tsedu, and I am part of the Freedom Park delegation, which, if you would recall, earlier in the year, Freedom Park had taken the initiative to collate and convene arts practitioners, artists, managers, practitioners themselves from various forums and areas of the industry to say, given the challenges that have emanated as a result of the lockdown restrictions that were obviously dictated by the coronavirus, what can be done to get the industry, firstly, to find one another, because there were indeed various voices coming from all types of practitioners. Some were incoherent, some were incoherent with what government was trying to do. And Freedom Park then realized that as an institution which one of its mandates is to facilitate dialogues around the country, we thought it was indeed necessary for the arts industry to have a dialogue where out of it, we believed that the messages would not then go over one another, but would be messages of unison to try and get this industry on track, but also get both government and or the department and artists or practitioners themselves to talk. And we were quite delighted that the initiative that we indeed supported came to fruition. It became a reality, and we are meeting today because a lot of work has happened, a lot of work has been done to try and achieve that objective. Ladies and gentlemen, let me, by so doing, welcome all of you to this feedback session, which we are hosting today, so that we are able to get an idea, or at least a report back as to what has happened out of the initiatives that were started earlier in the year, the committees that were formed and the platforms or forums that were established. How far have we come? But to do the formal welcome, in fact, let me just ask CEO to do that honors and just welcome all of you. Jin Famadi, you've been there from day one. This is where we are at today. Please just welcome the guests and all the participants.
Thank you, Program Director, Mr. Tsedu. Good afternoon, members of the MAT. Good afternoon to the sector, to all participants. Mine will just be a very brief welcome. Mr. Tsedu has really given the background. Just to acknowledge and appreciate your commitment with this that we started earlier this year. You will recall that we had the first engagement. So can I request that everybody mutes? Okay, I will. Thank you. I will continue.
Mute and allow the CEO to come.
Thank you, Program Director. You will recall that we had two sessions. One of the first one on the 30th of January, and then after that there was a recommendation that we need a follow up, which we had on the 7th of February. The outcome of those engagements was that there is a need to form a task team comprising of the creative industry as experts and also as people who understand themselves the challenges that the sector is faced with, particularly in the light of the COVID-19 pandemic. Indeed, after that engagement, we really appreciate the response from the sector. And I just want to indicate as a way of reminder that we requested the organizations, various organizations within the creative sectors, to recommend names of the people that will form the task team. And one of the criteria being that the organizations should be organizations that have a national footprint. And indeed that happened. The task team was formed, and also we appreciate and acknowledge the support by the Department of Sports, Arts and Culture and our Minister Natim Tetwa, in that when we hosted that discussions, we indicated to him that what we require of him was to come and listen so that the creative sector will take the lead in sharing the challenges, but also in coming up with the recommendations. We're excited that this has happened. And when the task team, the MAT, was formed at the time, they were given a 6-month period to go and do the work. And the purpose of today really is because 6 months has passed and we are here today so that we can get feedback from the ministerial advisory team, task team, to understand how far have they gone in mitigating and in addressing some of the challenges, what are the outstanding challenges that are still there, and what needs to happen. So today's meeting really is a feedback session to understand how far, what are the challenges that they experienced in the process, and what needs to happen, so that also they can tap in the larger collective in terms of what more needs to be done, but mainly also as we look at the fact that it is the end of the 6-month period that was given. So for me, I as I've indicated, as Freedom Park, we really appreciate and we are humbled by the response from the creative sector to participate in this platform, but also to take the lead in terms of what needs to happen in order to mitigate the various challenges that you are faced with as a sector. And having said that, I'm looking forward to listening to Sharif and the team in terms of how far, and also to listen to the further engagement from the sector. I thank you, Program Director.
CEO, thank you very much. And indeed, colleagues, I think one cannot emphasize the spirit with which we have always approached these sessions, these dialogues. In fact, impact starting from the first one, which was very emotive. In the part of that very emotive session, we were able to get to the second session with the minister and involvement throughout this process can only be commended. And by so saying, also appreciating the department for having taken note of the need of students as a lawyer industry is well represented, but most importantly in the programs going forward. Without any waste of time, let me now invite Sharif to then give us a presentation on the report back, and then from there I will then advise on how we approach the program going forward. Sharif.
Thank you, Mpo. Thank you, Mom Jane. Good afternoon, friends, brothers, sisters, colleagues in the creative industry. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Sharif Baker. And together with me here today are the fellow colleagues of the Ministerial Advisory Team, which is Gabrielle Leroux, it is China Mpololo, it is Tobela Damini, it is Joy Mbawena, and I'm hoping Sis Nozi has joined us, but I know she has technical challenges with regards to access to Wi-Fi as she is on the road. But allow me to take this opportunity to thank you for the attendance, and thank you for the opportunity for us that come from you, from the creative sector, to give our feedback report to our sector, to our creatives, so they understand exactly the work that we've put in thus far and work that still needs to be done for our creative sector. So amid this crisis that we are in, which is obviously COVID-19. A lot of work has been done, but just before I get to the presentation, I would like to ask Gabby to say a few things, because although the presentation speaks specifically to the work streams, there were quite a few other engagements that took place that the MAT managed to get their hands involved with and assist in our creative sector. So, Gabby, if you don't mind joining in.
Thank you, Chair. Firstly, if I can just find out from the host if the session is being recorded. We've got a lot of people asked us, look, they can't attend, but they would love to catch up afterwards. So is there a recording going that all of us can share to our social media pages? Is that possible?
Yes, it is being recorded. Not sure how we'll approach the sharing part, but yes, it is being recorded.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. Much appreciated. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for taking the time out to join us. And thank you also, Chair, for giving me this quick opportunity just to say a few words. Outside of our work streams, if I can just go back a little bit, each of us had our own way of arriving here, arriving in this team. It was essentially we had to make a decision whether we would want to engage with the ministry, or we want to engage with the department. Many of us have spent a lot of time fighting the ministry and fighting the department. But at the same time, particularly in the conditions of COVID, the the driving force was always the best possible outcome, short term, now during COVID, short term for the sector who we are all part of. And essentially, if everybody can just bear in mind, that's kind of where we come from, where we how we landed up in this position, to engage with the minister, to advise the minister, to fall out with the minister, to debate with the minister, and the same with the department that all of us know that we've crossed swords with so many times. So let there be no mystery about it. We came into this kind of all of us also taking a risk, all of us sometimes perhaps being skeptical, other times having to assess ourselves, looking at our own state of mind and looking at the memberships that we may represent, etc. And at the end of the day, we all agreed, look, we're going to give it a go and we're going to engage with the ministry, we're going to engage with the department, and hopefully some good can come out of that for our collective, our colleagues in the creative sector. Over and above the six work streams that will be presented to you today, there's a couple of other things that came along the way. One is a very, very tangible one. One was our engagement and our involvement, our direct involvement with the recent third phase distribution of relief. That is still ongoing. We know the organizations is still, waiting for their outcomes, etc. But the good news is that around 6,500 people each got 10,000 Rand in their bank account. Now, that's not a lot of money, but bear in mind that in our sector and for our department, there was never a lot of money in the kitty in the first place. And willy-nilly, then the Treasury would still come and take half of it when we get granted a PSP opportunity or economic stimulus package. So there was never enough money to work with, but in those circumstances, we're quite proud that we managed to create a support team that was there, that interacted with individuals on a one-on-one basis and managed to get thousands of people compliant to be able for them to be paid that 10,000 Rand. Yes, it's not 10,000 Rand is not going to go a long way, but for anybody who received that, I mean, from the amount of feedback that we got, people were truly, truly grateful. And we are so relieved that we managed to make that input over and above the work streams that we were engaged in. More recently, there's the NAC grant, the NAC funding that's open at the moment. As far as I know, the deadline is this coming Friday. We had a problem with that. We confronted the NAC saying that, because if you guys read the requirements again, they've now reverted to the fact that even individuals have to be tax compliant. And we had an issue with that, and we still do. We felt that we just managed to get thousands of creative practitioners that were never registered for tax are now registered, because they had to do that in order to at least show that they are registered to be able to receive the third phase funding. Now, immediately with the next funding tranche, you're reverting back to having them to have to be tax compliant. So we took the NAC on via the department, via the office of the DDG, and we suggested to them, look, at the very least, consider individuals to be compliant, even if they're not tax compliant, but as long as they can show you tax registration. And then should they be compliant enough to be able to afford that funding, you can always take the tax off them and give them an IRP5 so that with their next return, they can show that that tax has already been deducted. The NAC responded I don't want to show it an olive, call it an olive branch. I'd rather say that it's a counter offer, which we collectively, and we would love to have opinions on that. And perhaps later in the questions and answer, maybe some of you can give your opinions on that. But that they are happy to consider individuals who are not tax compliant, but before they get to the contract stage, by the end of November, the 30th of November, they have to show tax compliance. So that would give them effectively about 2.5 months to just get basic financial statements, present that to SARS, and get a PIN on the basis of that. So that's going to make it open it for a lot of individuals who would not be able to even apply because they're not tax compliant right now. So that opens a window for a lot more individuals to be able to apply. So those are the type of things. And then just very shortly, we were engaged for a period of initially 6 months. And as you will see, all of the work streams, bar one, is still in the process. We're getting real good progress in it, but we were simply not able to finish all of these work streams within the period of 6 months. But you'll get a very good idea of the progress, where we are, and what it is that we're trying to do in the various work streams. So for that, for now, I would suggest people try and concentrate, look what there is, and come to this with an open mind and ask whatever questions you would like. We would like to just give you the most honest and open feedback that we can. Thank you very much, Chair. That's me for now.
Thank you, Gabby. I also would like to bring up that, by direct action of the MAT, we managed to get involved and assist in the third phase by bringing in a mop-up team, because we could see the department was just not handling it and was not holding it together, making sure our creatives got the relief that has been sorely needed. And by virtue of us stepping in and assisting by guiding and showing them, because we are from the sector, we are creatives, we managed to get involved there. Likewise, we've managed to get involved with NEDLAC and with NAC joints, where we're speaking specifically about how we can assist in reopening our sector that has been dying for the last 19 months. And it's not a joke, it's not funny. And we need to do something. And by virtue of the MAT's involvement with the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture, NEDLAC has invited us in, and we actively engaged with them together with a whole host of associations to make sure that we're all speaking the same voice in trying to get it reopened. And this, again, is by direct action because of the MAT. Before I step over to the presentation, I'd just like to advise you that the presentation will take place. It's the exact presentation that was presented both to the Minister and the Portfolio Committee. So I will be narrating throughout each presentation, and then towards the end, we'll take questions and answers. So if you don't mind jotting down your Q&A and holding on until the end, or putting it into the chat box, that will be greatly appreciated. And as I'm opening the presentation, I just need to let you know that after consultation with the Minister and putting pressure on him, I am glad to announce that the hard work by our creatives' voice that has taken place, there is an imminent fiduciary and report on the challenges that took place with the NAC, and that report will be coming to us momentarily. I'm hoping over the next week or two, a full report on what took place with regards to the National Arts Council. Can everybody see the presentation?
Yeah, it is visible.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, as was guided, we were put together and we presented this presentation both to the Minister and the Department, as well as the Portfolio Commission. So we obviously said that no matter what, whatever we present to anyone else, we will present the same to our creative sector so they know and have a total understanding. Now, some of it is a little bit repetitious, but I would rather go through it so that everybody understands the background and what we have gone through. Now, obviously, the background speaks for itself. COVID has hit us, and it's hit us hard, and we have been robbed of any possibility to practice in our creative sector. We are losing livelihoods. These are facts. We are losing many, many, many things, and this is a fact that cannot be compared to any other industry in this country. And I maybe be biased, but as a creative, that's exactly how I feel. And I will tell you, if you haven't heard or seen or watched the Portfolio Committee presentation, I laid it squarely at the feet of government and parliament, because we have been totally ignored. And thus, they need to understand and know the background of our creative industry, because as much as there is minerals in this country, diamonds and gold, the most powerful and most valuable asset to South Africa is our African culture, and they are trampling on it as we go through these 19 months. So that's some of the background that we gave. And as Mum Jane indicated, that there were a couple of meetings that took place by virtue and by courtesy of Freedom Park to seek an outcome of ensuring the creative and cultural communication and action was curated and expressed with one voice. And we applaud Mum Jane and Freedom Park for putting this initiative together and thankful for it. A lot of this came out, a lot of the actions that we have done, whether individually or via various associations, which includes, for example, the Light SA Red campaign that took place in August last year, which was the catalyst to get everybody understanding and knowing that who we are, that we are somebody as well. We are not just a banker that earns his salary sitting at home because he doesn't have to go to work. We are a cultural and creative industry, and we and our lives matter. So based on those engagements of Freedom Park, and as Mum Jane said, a collective curated unilaterally terms of reference. Those terms of reference came from that meeting to say, these are the work streams and these are the challenges that lay at the feet of the creative sector, and that we need to address this so that we can make sure our creative sector can try and find some form of normality. And thus, soon after the Freedom Park engagements, the MAT was selected, and the first meeting was proposed to be held in person, where each MAP member would be allocated a department line official. So each of us had a work stream, but a department member that could speak to our specific work stream was seconded to us so that we had direct access into the department and communication over and above our weekly meetings with the minister and the senior officials. To that, a secretariat was also given to the MAT team to capture each and every meeting, to notarize each and every meeting, and make sure it was minuted for various reasons, which I obviously don't need to go through, but more specifically so that we could present to the portfolio committee. Based on all of this, everything was done in accordance to law and legality. And on the 17th of February, letters of appointment were issued to all the members, and then a terms of reference was written and established. Now, the terms of references are probably about a 2-3 pager, but the phrase and the paragraph that is in front of you, for me, is the spine of the appointment, and for me is still indicative of the team's mandate today, and thus is an apt statement in the overview of this document. And that term speaks that this document serves as draft terms of reference for the Arts and Culture Task Team appointed to advise and assist the ministry and the department in the sustainability of our arts and culture sector, with the mandate, keyword, of the department to safeguard, preserve, and promote South Africa's creative and cultural history. And I say that loud and proud, because it is as of this specific paragraph that we, the MAT, and by virtue the sector, hold the department accountable. And I would like to reiterate on this, as Gabby said in the beginning, we made it constantly clear to the department, we do not work for the department, we work for the sector. We are here for the sector. We are not saying you are answerable to us, but we are not answerable to you. We don't work for you. We don't pay our salaries. This is what we are being put together for, to bridge the divide between the department and the sector so that we can find a way of working together. So based on that, the MAT was divided into five strategic work streams that work closely with the department. Work stream one is banking and landlords, which has grown since then, which speaks to SARS, which speaks to the Department of Human Settlements, which speaks to the DITC, and speaks to the National Treasury. But I'll unpack that as we go along, and by virtue is one of the larger work streams that we're working on. This has been spearheaded by myself and China Mbololo. Work stream two, which is the wellness portfolio, which again, this was curated out of the terms of reference of Freedom Park in January. and is being spearheaded by our own Joy Mbawena, as well as Nozipho Dlamini-Ngusi, to oversight and overview the service provider that is rolling out the wellness portfolio known as SILAPA. Workstream three is the school fees portfolio, headed up by Gabby LaRue. Workstream four is retail and transport, and all of these will be unpacked as I go through the presentation, again, headed up by Gabby LaRue. And then Workstream five is the private and corporate sector portfolios, headed up by Thobela Dlamini. Now, these work streams were put together over and above us working, whether it be our individual cells or associations or collective, in trying to make sure that we can be reopened or increase the gathering so that we can work. These ones were put together because of direct damage and implications and challenges for our sector, whereby the private and corporate sector needed to come on board, or needs to come on board, because clearly government hasn't got sufficient money to look after everybody. And by virtue of the corporate sector, for want of a better phrase, exploiting our talents, whether it be acting on an advert or using our song on a ringtone tune or the likes thereof, yes, we enjoy royalties. But if you look at the royalties versus the millions of rands that the corporate sector enjoy because of making use of our creativeness, it is only but fair and just that the creative sector step up and assist both the government and the creative sector in making sure that we can stay alive. So that is where Workstream 5 came in. The understanding for Workstream 4 on retail and transport is by virtue that can we go to a Pick and Pay, a ShopRite, a Spa, or the likes thereof, either to get a voucher, either to be assisted with a meal bag, or at the very least, by virtue of a care card, let the creative sector enjoy a cost price on a loaf of bread, rather than us paying a premium price and including of profit. That is still under discussion and working on. Likewise with transport, especially with government transport, we are seeking assistance. Many of us are trying to find another job, or many of us are even trying to get to our loved ones because either they're ill or they need assistance, or we just need to get out of the house because being cooped up in a box is creating a mental challenge, and thus our engagement with the Department of Transport. School fees came about because many in our sector that go to government schools or school paying government schools, our children were either being harassed and bullied by fellow students. Yeah, my parents pay school fees and yours don't. That is a mental challenge. Or the school governing body or the school was harassing the parents, and we don't have that type of money right now because we're not working, and thus we needed to engage there. The banking and landlords portfolio is where I'm going to go to, because that's going to be the first work stream I'm going to unpack. So I'll give you those details as we get to the work streams. But these work streams, as you can see in this slide, the work stream one is current and ongoing. A wellness portfolio is current as of oversight to the service provider. Work stream three, which is the school fees, has been completed. And work stream four and five are still current and ongoing. Now, as of the ethos of intervention on all the work streams, all and R will be curated as sustainable programs moving forward. So, for example, the creation of the feasible system of the care card facility, as suggested by the retail and transports work stream, that can be used in the future as like a SASSA card that will be able to assist creatives and applying for funding, or you not just looking for transport or for retail, but just makes life easier when we're applying for funding from DSAC or applying from NAC, because we are registered and that care card would work. It's easier for them even to put the money over into that card or to that care card. But those are still discussions that are ongoing. We're also looking to be able to create employment by producing musical, theatrical and spoken word opportunities for the activations, rollouts and communication of wellness throughout the country for the Salapa program. And this is a passion project being spearheaded by Joy Mbawana, which she will discuss a little later on, where we are trying to say, yes, there's a wellness program for mental health or financial health, but let's use our creatives to earn some money and be part of this so that we can do activations and rollouts accordingly. We're also speaking about the engagements with the corporate sector, like I said, especially with regards to copyrights and royalties and fair trade practices that have equilibrium and are reciprocal, as I spoke about earlier on, whilst alleviating government of full or total responsibility of financial assistance to the sector. The banking program is engaged to implement tax policy adjustments that are tailored for the creative sector by virtue of understanding the dynamics thereof. And I'll unpack that shortly as well. As well as adjustments to the employment and labor policies that look at freelancers in our sector being able to contribute to UIF and thus being able to have access to a pension fund and the rights as a person of trade in the South Africa. So those are our visions. Now, the conclusion of the presentation, before I go into the depth of the work streams, was that the initiative of the MAT by the minister, in general, in our opinion, has proven to be an invaluable asset to both the department and the ministry, but most importantly, the sector. By virtue of even the minimal successes and implementations, it is evident the journey is not over. And in simple terms, the overreaching successes that we have managed to accomplish is that we've got hands on the sector relief in such that there is representation, that there is real-time communication between the sector and the department when it comes to activations and implementations. So much so that the department actually turned to us as creatives for advice, because most of them are politicians or number crunchers and do not come from the creative sector and do not understand how we think. We are exacting tasks with advice on relief measures and or actions that either the department or minister would ordinarily miss, like I said, as of not being a creative. And then it is giving us access to further government departments, as in the Department of Human Settlements, National Treasury, SARS, DTI, and the Department of Employment and Labour. But what we are trying to do now by virtue of these work streams is look beyond relief and gain intervention. Whatever we're doing now can't just last for 6 months. It needs to last as a legacy moving on to the next generation of creatives. So a time has come to acknowledge that a system of ongoing intervention and relief measures is not sustainable. It is time to move into a future that now supports sustainable programs that will contribute to relaunching and growing the cultural industry. So there are solutions afoot that must ensure immediate to medium term to longer term outcomes. Obviously, the immediate to medium was to alleviate COVID-19 impacts, whilst the medium to long term is to look at resuscitating our sector in the context of the country's overall economic recovery and reconstruction plan. Now, please bear in mind, my fellow creators, that most of us in the MAT are creators. We come from you. We are you. We've had to learn so much with regards to outside our box of creativity from an administrator, from a business, from a tax, from various aspects. And we've learned so much as we've moved along in these 6 months. But these 6 months have been a drop in the ocean of time in trying to execute the work streams that we are trying to accomplish in. And thus, we will continue to work tirelessly to support our industry. And now I'm going to go into the work streams specifically. And the first one is the banking and landlords. Now, I'm just going to touch on each presentation because I'm pretty sure most of you will be able to read through it and then perhaps jot down some questions if you have afterwards. So work stream one was brought about because of the concerns in our creative financial and fiduciary challenges that came out of the lockdown. Obviously, we can't pay our bonds, we can't pay our cars, we can't service our loans and the likes thereof. It was clear that intervention is needed because now our bills are just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And not being able to meet these commitments as a result of the global challenge and the South African challenge has added to the poor understanding or inconsiderate administrative operations of both the private and banking sectors towards us as the creatives. So to this end, objectives were curated for immediate action. We needed to look at evictions and landlords, look at the COIDA and TERS system, COIDA being the workman's compensation, SARS policy relief, National Treasury allocation of funding, considering they just stripped us of 600 million rand right at the beginning, because why? Are we just the creative sector and we don't need it? Doesn't work that way. Labor law adjustments for the freelance community. Speaking with the DTI as of adjustments to the National Credit Act and relief by the National Credit Regulator, which they took away in the first 3 weeks. And again, I'll unpack that shortly. DTI releasing cultural creative industry contributions that's made by the sector for use to alleviate financial burdens. There is a pot of money sitting at the DTI that we have contributed to, yet we don't have access to it. Why? And we are in engagement with that. We're also seeking assistance via the SA Banking Association and adjustments via the Credit Ombudsman to the financial service providers of the plight of the creative. And I will unpack that shortly as well. So when it comes to evictions and landlords, the action that we took was to investigate on whom we need to speak with and the research possibilities, and then look to request for a meeting with COGTA, who drafted and sent out on the 10th of March the regulation 73 and 74 with regards to evictions and landlords. We then, based on that, the communications that took place, we received a reply from the Chief Director Brewer and Director Daisel at the at COGTA, and a meeting took place, as you can see, on the 16th of March. It was a good engagement, who guided us on the specific regulations and the Act, and then pointed out the next steps of engagement because of Regulation 73-74. Now, the custodians of eviction and landlords sits with the Department of Human Settlements. Thus, we then now made a request to Minister Natia Mthethwa to reach out to his counterpart, Minister Sisulu, so that we can engage on a high level and not be just speaking to somebody that answers the phone at the Department of Human Settlements. This was then put together, and we met with Director General Leshabani, who on the 24th of May, that guided us on a way forward, because the Department of Human Settlements are also the custodians of the Housing Tribunal. Now, when I'm speaking of eviction and landlords, I'm speaking in principle of homes rather than businesses, but the principles do stay the same. So like I said, the outcomes and the desired outcomes is, as of the engagement with COGTA, we were able to send out communication to the sector as guidance to relief with regards to eviction on the 2nd of April. Now, that document was sent out, which could be used in connection with the other documents from Housing Tribunal to tell the landlord, no, you cannot evict us. Here's Regulation 73 and 74. You please need to abide by the laws of the Disaster Act. You cannot evict us. That document can even be sent to a bank, and it is a legal, lawful document and understanding under the Disaster Act that we cannot be evicted. But unfortunately, many of us, and even I, am guilty of fear of being intimidated by our landlords. I'm going to kick you out. I'm going to get the red ants. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. This document has helped us, but there's still more work that needs to take place. The document sent out assisted many in our sector, but it needed more backup, and thus the engagement with Director General Leshabane. He then sent to us advice and guidance that the Department of Human Settlements has now fragmented Housing Tribunal to regional offices rather than provincial, so that if a creative have challenges, they could go to their regional office and not still hunt to find where in the province is the office of the Housing Tribunal. And they are mandated to get involved to arbitrate and negotiate settlements based on the Act. The DG also advised, and we're waiting for that document to come out, an imminent rollout of relief rental package for anyone in our sector that is in arrears. There are full details, the terms and conditions that will apply to that, and we're waiting for the Department of Human Settlements to give us that. And this is, again, by direct intervention from the MAT speaking for the sector to the Department of Human Settlements that have now realized the challenges that we live under. There are others, but ours is the most important. So one of the challenges that we are waiting for now is a signature of Minister to sign the Department of Human Settlements document that has all the details, and I've attached it here, just so that we can send that out. But many in our sector have succumbed to fear-mongery, to intimidation and threats. And this is something that we now need to make sure that there's a communications drive from DSAC and MAT that can guide our creative brothers and sisters on a way forward. And whilst we're waiting for this document is because we are waiting for Human Settlements to send us the document of relief that depicts our way forward. So the next steps for eviction and landlords is getting the document signed, arranging webinars via DSAC, and including a legal person to explain the eviction process and your rights. Now, let me just stop there. Let's put aside COVID. Let's put aside the pandemic. The law states in order for you to be evicted, there has to be a court order. It is not a landlord that's coming there with his chummy from the police station to say out. It doesn't work that way. You have to have a court order. And in order to get that court order, it takes anywhere between 6 and 8 months. And that is outside of COVID. Inside of COVID, if there is a court order issued, it's going to take longer to get that court order to be evicted. Not that we're using this as a loophole, but we need to, for our creatives to understand this so they can sleep at night and not worry that somebody's going to knock on their door 2 o'clock in the morning and try and pull them out to kick them out, because it's not going to happen. Coupled with that, we need to engage with SA banks to try and relax the challenges of bond repayments that are not being met as a homeowner that is a creative and is owns the house or has rented his or out to a creative. So that engagement needs to take place, and you will hear about it as I move on to the next presentations. With regards to COIDA and TERS, the action was to research the challenges, especially for our sector companies, and formulate a plan with discussion with the Department of Employment and Labour. And I say this again, we had to do research because I'm a creative. I know what I do in my industry, but I don't know how to work with employment and labour. So the implementation or communication was to request a meeting with the minister by our minister, which was done on the 2nd of April. And then meet with the representatives of employment and labor, which took place on the 12th of April with Commissioner Mafata and Acting Commissioner Marsha Bronkhorst. And this, as you can see, the documents in front of you is a timeline of the communication that was sent and received. The outcome. So policies have been revised to accommodate the challenges of the pandemic. And this again speaks by the action of the MAT. But right now it only assists our creative companies, registered companies. So COIDA, which is the Compensation for Occupational Industries and Disease, also known as Workmen's Compensation Fund, has been adjusted by the percentage variance from 29% to 50%. So that's over half, which you are now saving, allowing for freedom of economic restraint, as well as creating a payoff scheme, which we insisted on over 12 months. So that would gain and alleviate the pressure of full payments, but yet you will be able to get a letter of good standing. Now, many of you will know that a letter of good standing means outside of a government tender, if you are going to go and be a technical supplier or a creative supplier or a theatrical supplier to corporate, say Vodacom, you would need a letter of good standing to make sure that you would be able to enjoy that tender or that RFQ. What we also managed to put into place is, as of the discrepancy in the SIC codes, which everybody has heard about, standard industrial classification codes, they have put an appeal system into place. implemented by the Department of Employment and Labour, so that you can provide, as long as you provide a portfolio of evidence that your company is indeed operating in the creative sector, you would then be able to apply and enjoy TERS relief from October 2020 to March 2021, which I see now has been extended. But I will tell you this, the Department of Employment and Labour are sorely lacking in their service and sorely lacking in getting to it fast enough to look after many of our creative practitioners, especially in the technical world and the theatre world. It is rather frustrating. And as much as we complain to them bitterly, it's almost landing on deaf ears. But it doesn't stop us from complaining to them. It doesn't stop us from communicating with them to tell them what we need to do. And this speaks to many of the challenges. If you try and log in, there are IT challenges, and the biggest factor when the system keeps crashing. Also, there was an applications appeal by a sector that deferred us to Annexure B, behind other applicants who have been not been suffering for 17 months. So in that time when there was a lockdown again and the restaurants had to close, as soon as they opened up after 3 weeks or 3 months, whatever it was, they were given first right of access to TERS, and we've complained bitterly about it. Why are we put on the back foot when we have been shut for 18 to 19 months? So the SIC code still poses a challenge for many of us in the sector, but we are pushing forth. The biggest challenge in the process and payment to our sector has caused emotional mayhem, and justifiably so. And this is the challenges that we're trying to push across. So the next steps, in collaboration with the SA Events Council and SAARCI, we are in discussion with key role players at the department to resolve the situation, especially led by Alan Raghavalu from the Department of Employment and Labour. This process is painful and is slow, but I will say Glenton de Kock, the CEO of SAARCI, is taking a lead, and he is fighting a very good battle in making sure that we are pushed continuously to the front of the queue when it comes to TERS payment. We also engage with the SA Banking Association. Now, let me tell you, the SA Banking Association is made up of CEOs of all the national banks, which I didn't realize until, you know, I got involved with them. And the intention for the engagement was to ascertain how the banks could help us because of the default in payments and the challenges that are in front of us. And the thus further extension of any financial agreement needs to be resolved or try and assist it with. So if we've got a bond for 20 years, can we now make it 25 years because we are struggling, or likewise with a car? So a meeting was arranged on the 24th of February, where the senior general manager of the association, Mr. Mark Britz, and I encourage you to take down his name and Google it so you'll see where his rank is. That meeting took place, and the outcome was as thus. The communication was very informative and gave a much better understanding of the banking sector. They are really held to ransom because of laws under the Constitution. The most important factor is that the association, and by virtue of all the banks within the association, are and will to assist, but it will need capital injection, and perhaps via the PSP or the LGS system. However, Mr. Britz did advise us on the complexity of the LGS, and we suggested we engage with National Treasury for guidance. Now, let me explain to you why. The loan guarantee scheme, which was 200 billion, as the president spoke about, was given to be activated via the banks to assist anybody that needed assistance in the short term because of what was going on with the pandemic. And how the loan guarantee scheme is, if I went to go borrow 10 rand from the bank and unfortunately happened to default, they would be able to get the money back from the government. What the government failed to tell us is that they never gave the banks 200 billion rand. They instructed the banks to use from their depositors' money, and if anybody were to default, they would come back to the government and claim it. Now, any businessman will tell you, why must I use my own money and then still wait another 10 years to get my money back if company X is defaulted? And thus, you will find that the loan guarantee scheme only managed to dish out, I think it was 29% of the allocated funds, purely because now it was a scheme that did not work. So this is why he said to speak to National Treasury to see what we can do. And the reason being is, if we could come up with an amount of 200 million rand, they would be able to activate it within the SA Banking Association and curate it via their actuarists so that they could then service our interests at a loan account or a HB account or a bond account for 6 to 8 months, which would take the banks off our backs from getting involved or harassing us or beg or insisting on money from us. So they are willing to help us. And thus he guided me back to National Treasury to try and get the 200 million rand. The challenge, obviously, as a result of meeting Mr. Briss, that the current banking laws could not defer or relax any payments as of the existence of the pandemic. And thus, again, insisted on us going to see how, if we could raise 200 million rands. Otherwise, defaulters would be held liable. So what were the next steps? To engage both with the department and National Treasury to seek assistance and raise the 200 million rand. Unfortunately, so far as of the complexities of the financial world, it became clear that a task team would be needed to explore and execute our intentions, because again, I am not a banker. I'd like to pause here for a second to make sure everybody can still hear me and is still seeing all the presentation, if I can get an acknowledgement.
Yes, we can, but I wanted to actually come in. It's good that you have requested that we indicate. I wanted to come in to say, realizing that we still have how many? Four other work streams to go through. If you could be as not brief, but detailed in a in a brief manner. Thanks.
I understand. Thank you. Fortunately, this one is the biggest one out of all of them. The others will go a lot quicker, but I'll move on a lot quicker with this work stream. So what we did was put together some qualified people from the industry to assist us with the banking sector and to meet with SARS. As you can see, these are the names that got put together. Justin van Wyk, who comes from the creative sector, is the owner of Big Concerts and is by virtue, didn't even know that, he's a qualified chartered accountant. And then Yusuf is a CFO of a large alternative financial service provider. And just to give you feedback, an alternative financial service provider is like a direct access Spartan, some of the alternative banks that give us financing. We included Kevin Jones as of his diploma and understanding of business and banking management. And then the others, Glenton is also chairperson of Saki, and Sam September and Tess come from the industry. Thus, meetings were put together and sent by our DG to SARS Commissioner on the 10th of April. As you can see, that's a letter that went out to the Commissioner requesting the meeting. At the meeting, and it started off with SARS before we went to the Department of National Treasury, there was a meeting that was put together with Mark Klingon of the stakeholder engagements on the 19th of April, where we proposed various things, and I'm not going to go into detail here, but some of the things that would speak specifically to individuals in the creative sector is A, if you have a company, we want to defer output VAT for 24 months post-COVID, so that at least that 15% we will be able to use to kickstart and revitalize our business. And secondly, on an individual level, to scrap the 26% tax, provincial tax that we are being charged for at least 24 months post-COVID to maybe a 5%, so that we again can also kickstart our lives in the industry. And then on review, look at how we can adjust and augment the provincial tax system that speaks better to the creative sector. So these are some of the, and I can share this with you, Mpho, so we can send out all these details to our creatives so they can read through it in detail, because what I am going to do is move speedily along now as per your request. But these are all the things that we're discussing with SARS, and there's a lot of detail behind it. The outcome based on our request was further meetings with SARS and a reply via the SARS commissioner to DG Mkhize that speaks to exactly what we have been requesting. The next steps based on SARS was that we needed to meet with National Treasury because they're joint at the hip. And thus we waited a long time to try and get this this meeting with National Treasury. But after a meeting with National Treasury, it was clear we were being passed around like a tennis ball, with National Treasury advising on many of the discussions needed to go back to SARS. So the unfortunate thing is that that meeting with National Treasury, it was only National Treasury. So they bounced us back to SARS. And when we went to SARS, they bounced us back to National Treasury. And it was rather frustrating until we put our foot down as the MAT. National Treasury came back with a lot of responses based on our documentation and requests, as you can see there. And then we obviously went back to SARS for a reboot. And it was at this meeting that we actually got hold of them and put our foot down by virtue of saying the Minister of Finance has publicly said that there is a tax solution for the taxi industry. So what is good for the goose is good for the gander. We also need a tax solution for the creative sector. We cannot live in limbo and in fear in our creative sector, especially under this pandemic. And the outcome of the meeting was that the next meeting was to be held was putting SARS and National Treasury in the same room so that we can formulate a plan. And we are now waiting for that exact meeting because this meeting is going to take place with SARS, National Treasury, MAT, but on a commissioner and DG level. Again, not just on the people that we met the first time that brushed us off. We have got, we even replied back to the National Treasury, as you can see in the red, of the replies that they gave to us, counteracting what they are suggesting, because they are speaking from a policy level and not realizing we are creatives and they need to understand the creative industry contributes 2.2% to the GDP, which is almost 100 billion rand. That is a lot of money. And in fact, we compare right up there with the mining sector. So we cannot be treated, National Treasury or SARS, with contempt. And this is the fight that we are on at the moment. So I'm going to skip through this. The hierarchy from both sides will get involved and find solutions. The challenge I would tell you is that we are looking for solutions immediately under the Disaster Act so that policy can be changed, because they keep throwing in our face, it is policy, it is policy. And unfortunately, the National Treasury sits in the Constitution. It's the only government department that sits and is governed by the Constitution. So if policy needs change, we have to go back to the Constitution and Constitutional Court to amend. So our argument is, but we can do it under the Disaster Act. Please help us. So we are busy setting up the next meetings with National Treasury and putting ourselves into a position where we can fight the battle so that we can get money from SARS, relief from SARS, and money from National Treasury so we can go back to the SA Banking Solution Association so we can try and get this assistance. Currently, the National Treasury that we are speaking to, and I didn't even realize there was a department that speaks to the Director of Labor of Arts specifically for us, is a lady called Judy Naidu. That was a very nice lady, but just gave us the runaround and shoved us back to the department. So it is clear we are not being respected by government and by parliament and departments in government. And this is why I made it categorically clear in the Portfolio Commission. So there's a lot of presentations that we've spent and sent to the National Treasury. And here's some of just a quick overview and snapshots of what we've been sending to them. And we've advised the minister every step of the way and how we've been able to put together and investigate solutions to mitigate the challenges within the creative sector. So everything is in black and white and has been presented, as well as the current outcomes. And again, the one thing that we are looking for immediately is 200 million rand, just so that we can sort out our creative that's about to lose his home or lose his car or service his loan. That is the most important thing that we are trying to do now. And I say again, we're in anticipation of the next meetings with the Department of National Treasury. So I'm going to skip through this because it just gives you more detail on it. I'm just going to stop here Department of Trade and Industry are the custodians of the National Credit Act, which speaks to the National Credit Regulator. And they are the ones that need to speak to the banks and alternative banks to give us reprieve. For the first 3 months it was there, then Minister Patel stripped us of it. And he is avoiding us currently to engage so we can find out why they are not giving relief to the banks, which in turn would give relief to the creative sector. And this is something that we're working vehemently on so that we can try and get a result for our creative sector. Skip through all of these. Labor law adjustments speak specifically to what we are trying to do. And many of the associations have already engaged with Mr. Makalipi, who is the current acting DG from the Department of Labor. SAGA, the South African Guild of Actors, as well as a few other associations have taken the lead role in trying to engage with them to try and change policy that speaks to freelancers, whether you're an actor, whether you're a technical supplier, whether you're an artist. That is ongoing and an engagement that we are trying to follow up with. MAT got engaged with them, but we were treated with such dissent, it actually became very disrespectful, and we have complained bitterly to DG and Minister Mtetwa to engage with their counterparts so that we can rectify this, so we can have an open and engaging conversation and not be treated again like dirt. So these are the associations that have currently participated with the Department of Labor. And I'll pause here for a second so you can just read the names here. CPA, the Commercial Producers Association, Crew Agents, the National Association of Model Agencies, the Association of Communication and Advertising, UASA, who's the union, SAGE, the South African Guild of Editors, Personal Managers Association, Independent Producers, SWIFT, Sisters Working in Film, the Writers Guild of South Africa, the Creative Resources Empowering, and then SAMHSA. Now we asked, but I don't see any of the other associations. I don't see TADA, I don't see SAKIA, I don't see TUMSA, I don't see any of the other associations. How did this come to bear? No, this is just the film and TV world. I said, but that is biased. We need to be a collective that is speaking with regards to the Department of Employment Labor. And this is where we are currently at the moment, which is a stalemate, but we are engaging, and they have now realized that we need to get everybody in the sector around the table to speak to labor law adjustments. And there is a pending, impending meeting that will take place soon that all the creative associations will be invited to so that we can speak with regards to labor law adjustments. And that is it, overview. I'm not gonna go through the details here because I've just gone through it. Now, I've had a very good meeting with the credit ombudsman that is willing to help every one of us in the sector, but their hands have been tied because of the National Credit Act. And again, the DTI, because it falls under them. They are allowed to reprimand banks, Lewis furniture stores, and the likes thereof, because they're all members of the ombudsman. And if they harass any one of us, they can be brought to bear or be punished or guided correctly. But because the National Credit Regulator and Act was stripped away and adjusted to say, no, carry on, don't worry, it's life as normal, we are being subjected to the harassment that is currently going on. And until we've got a meeting with the DTI, and both myself and Gabby have been waiting patiently, arguing patiently, sending a meeting request patiently. The minister to minister has even spoken. We are still waiting for the DTI to recognize there is a creative industry. I've spoken about DTI, I've spoken about NCA and credit. I spoke about the money that still sits there. And if we can get hold of DTI to give us from our own money that 200 million that we need to offset the interest rates of for our homes, we will all be sleeping better at night. But getting hold of the DTI, I say again, has been easier said than done. So that is the banking and landlord and SARS portfolio workstream. It's still ongoing, and it's the bigger one out of the five. All of the others will go swiftly along. like I intimated in the beginning, when it comes to this work stream, the wellness portfolio, it is an ongoing portfolio work stream via Sis Joy. And Sis Joy will give you, will answer any questions after I finish this presentation. But just so that you know, we are oversight and overview to the service provider in making sure that our creators are being looked after from their wellness, well-being, whether it be mental, whether it be physical, whether it be financial, and the likes thereof. And this is where this portfolio and work stream is going on. There isn't any further details on outcomes because the IP sits with the service provider. And again, should you wish to have any information, Sis Joy will answer any of the questions shortly. School fees, I unpacked earlier on. We engage with the Department of Basic Education, well, Gabby did, and with Joseph Marte, who is his line official from the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture. And again, it speaks to the challenges that we have gone through and are still going through. And with great success, we've managed to put together, provided you fill out all the documentation from the school asking for exemption, you will, and give a portfolio of evidence, you are exempt from paying school fees for 2020 and 2021. This is fact, this is law, this is undisputable, this is a guarantee. A government fee-paying school cannot extract any funds from you, provided you follow protocol with regards to all the paperwork and have given a form of a portfolio of evidence that you are part of the cultural and creative industry. So there is a lot more detail on this, and this has gone out, it has been communicated. But again, we have seen the need, and we have found the department wanting, and we are still engaging with them, that their communication structures needs to be beefed up or allowed for us, the MAT, to be able to communicate with our sector uninhibited so that we can give you this information constantly. But I will say this on this one, the Department of Basic Education and the Minister was all too happy to assist the creative industry. And because of the MAT's intervention, our creative sector, as well as many others outside of our sector, are now able to enjoy exemption from any form of school fees. But like I said, there are principles to observe where no creative sector parent child may be harassed or victimized for school fees. It is illegal, period. Recent funding of the 10K that came in via first, second, and third phase should not have to go to school fees. And we made this absolutely clear. We told the Department of Basic Education that schools cannot turn around to the creative sector and say, but you just got 10,000 Rand, give me some of that. It is illegal to do so. So this has been accomplished. And these are the timelines that we, from an audit perspective, with regards to the talks and the deadlines, and it has been accomplished. The approach was basic. We needed help for our sector, and it was achieved. And it has been documented, and it has, should you wish any of this documentation, we can assist. Likewise, these letters that have gone out from the Minister of Basic Education, as well as the Minister Moseko's response, as well as what we have put together. That rollout has happened, and if you have not got it, please make contact with any one of us. We will help you with the greatest of pleasure. This is the communique that went out, just so we can show you the communication did go out to the sector. And again, if you did not receive it, please, we encourage you to reach out to us so that we can share this information so you can go back to your school and make sure you can be justified in making sure you get exempt. And please note, no school can turn around and say, oh, the time for exemption has passed. That is illegal. You can walk in there today and fill out the documentation and apply for exemption. And I speak under correction, Gabby, you will guide me. It was the DG that said you can phone him directly. Yes, you can speak to any of the guys on the ground. They understand this. But if you have further challenges, you can speak to him directly, and he will pick up to the phone to that school and instruct accordingly. So that is the schooling portfolio. When it comes to retail and transport, like I unpacked earlier, we are really looking to see how we can curate some type of care card for our creative sector that will assist us in retail and transport. And this is the type of care card look and feel that we are busy with trying to create, so that you could walk in and either be allowed to get a voucher or a parcel, or at the very least, get to enjoy a discounted amount, whether it be on your food, on your data, or your pharmaceutical needs. And this care card will then be proof of portfolio of evidence for yourself as for coming from the creative sector with regards to whatever you want to do in the retail and transport work stream. So there are details on it and the project priority list. We're just showing you these as the work that it entails and the work that we're doing going forward, how we're engaging and how we're negotiating with various vendors. There are some big vendors that are in discussion. Unfortunately, we cannot name their names yet because we need to tie down those deals. And Gabby has got some big brand names that are willing to assist us and willing to reciprocate with regards to this care card. We obviously want to push this production and rollout quicker rather than later, and obviously make sure there are qualifying members that speak to it, all the various associations, national associations that can apply accordingly, so that we can make sure that these care cards can be issued to the right people and it doesn't get abused by somebody else outside of our sector, which would then be detrimental to us as creatives. So these are just a basic engagements to date that you can see in front of you. We're engaging with ShopRite, we're engaging with Pick n Pay, we're engaging with Spa. There are various others. I think Boxer has been engaged with, Choppies has been engaged with. There are various others, and Edcon has been engaged with. And it is evident that corporates initially were reluctant to engage because they've got their own economic challenges. But as of late, and again, this is why we're waiting for engagement with the Department of Trade, Industry and Competition, where we can now unpack this further. But there are many retailers that are now willing to help us because their GDP or their economics has grown over the last recent times in the last financial quarter, and they are willing to engage with us. This, again, is communication between the ministers that we have been trying to engage. So we're giving you a proof of portfolio of evidence of the work that we are doing, as well as showing you the responses that we have gone through and received with regards to the work that we're putting out with retail and transport. Again, like I said, this is ongoing, and most of the time our hands have been tied outside of the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture, because some of the other government departments, I say blatantly again, it's like they just don't care about us in the creative industry. There are a lot of letters and documentation, as you can see, that's prepared, that's going out. And in fact, post this presentation, many of these letters have already gone out and people have been engaged with. And even though we've passed our 6-month tenure, we as creatives know that our work is not done. And us as the MAT still are in existence, making sure the work gets done because it speaks to our creative sector. So there are many proposals, as you can see, that's been put forward with regards to this, which include access and working with the master plan and with NEDLAC. And this is how large and big this has become. And because we have a seat at the NEDLAC table, which speaks to the businesses of South Africa, we actually have a voice as MAT inside NEDLAC. And a lot of us are being listened to now, so that they understand that there is such a thing as the creative sector. The final portfolio is the private and corporate sector. And as you know, as I spoke to you earlier on, the private sector is where a lot of the money is in this country. And we need to tap into it. We need to get assistance. We need to get, based on the SECO's assessment of the MGE program, that private companies and other sponsors only provide 17% of total sponsorship. Everything else is coming out of the department, and that is just wrong. We need the private sector to get more engaged, not just because of COVID challenges. We need it post this, whether we're doing a theatrical production at the Joburg Civic Theater, or whether we're putting a festival on at Makufe, or whatever the case may be. I come back to each time I speak with them with Tobela, the African culture is the biggest asset this country has got, and it is not being utilized correctly compared to the rest of the world and Europe and America. And this can prove true by virtue of Master KG with Jerusalem. Look what it has done for this country. And that's just one person. There are thousands of us in the creative industry that can benefit from this, but we need corporate engagement, holding hands with us, making sure it works, so that we can not only make sure we are earning money, but we are creating jobs in our society. We're creating employment in our society, and perhaps creating our own funding scheme so that we don't have to rely constantly on the Department of Sports and Arts, and, or government for that matter. So this work stream has met with great success with engagements, with the amount of letters and invites that have gone out. We have engaged with 20 to 30 corporates, and there's a lot of engagement. Yes, in the beginning, many of them have got their own economic challenges because of the pandemic, but there are many that have realized they've earned more in COVID than they ever did before, without mentioning names. And we have used this as leverage to make sure that there is an alliance between the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture and the cultural and creative industry and the private sector. This now needs to be an inclusive alliance and not a fragmented alliance, which has been leading up to COVID-19. So we are looking at creating these engagements. These are some of the people that we've engaged with. And I can tell you now, and you can, again, in your Q&A, we have had great success, and we can engage immediately and help our creative sector with the SABC, with the South African Breweries, and with National Lottery. They are all willing to work with us, and they're not on the list because this is meetings that's taken place in the last week. And they are all willing to come to the party. We just now need to curate the document so we can assist our sector to have access to the SABC and to have access to National Lottery funding that is slowly going to be coming our way. So as you can see, some of the meetings that have gone out, this is just giving due diligence with the reporting and status report of acknowledgement and meeting held and meetings that's taking place and meetings that will be happening. Now, again, our successes, like we just said, SABC, National Lottery, as well as Standard Bank, which is not on here. And our one big thing that we've managed to put together with a private consortium, like there was Live Aid in Wembley in 1984, whatever the case may be, there is a company that's put together called Africa Aid, and their goal is to raise specifically 100 million rands for the creative sector. Not for South Africa, for the creative sector. They've committed to raising this 100 million rand. All we need is endorsement from the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture and government. We are in the process of getting these documents signed so this event can take place so that we can have access to that 100 million rand to give, not relief, to give recovery and opportunity for our creative sector. There have been challenges moving forward. Like I said earlier on, some of them have got their own challenges because of the economic challenges of the pandemic. But there are also many that just don't trust government. They're tired of all the corruption. They're tired of all the Zondo commissions. And they quite honestly are very skeptical getting involved with the creative sector or government for that matter. And our narrative is saying we are MAT, we are from the sector. You're not dealing with government. We may have backing or endorsement or working alongside the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture, but this is, in essence, a creative cultural industry sector initiative. And by virtue of that, we're putting plans into play that will speak to how the corporates can speak specifically to us, not via the NAC, not via the Department of Sports and Arts and Culture, but that will be coming up shortly. So the way forward is to push for more physical presentation, which we are doing. And again, it's not going to take 6 months. It's going to take a while, but we will get there for our creative sector. Again, not just for COVID-19, but for the creatives generally post COVID-19. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the presentation. I hand back to Mpho to facilitate facilitate questions and answers. Thank you, Mpho.
Thanks very much, Sheriff. That's quite a detailed presentation encompassing all the work that you have done, and indeed thank you for that presentation. What we are going to do now, colleagues, is I'm going to take hands. I can see now we have the first hand, and colleagues, perhaps let me just lay some ground rules. We do not have another hour and 45 minutes of presentation. I think I would like to request that, as the item says, this is a Q&A, questions for clarification, and I'm going to request that members of this work streams committees be on standby to deal with questions that relate to their areas of work. May the question, please don't give us preambles, and equally the answers. Can I request that please don't give us preambles? Let's hit straight to the question and let's get direct answers, so that at the end of this session, we then agree on way forward, what happens next, because what we do not want is talking sessions that end up not bringing any results. So quickly, let me start. Okay, I see a couple of hands. Let me start with Brian Mukwena. Brian, your question, please.
Thanks, Mpho. Mpho, I just wanted to know, man, what were the parameters of the MAT? Because I see that they cast their net wide and decided to deal with heavy stuff. So the question is, what was their original mandate, and what is it that they were meant to do? Because I mean, for example, issues of them dealing with banks and whatever, I found them to be a bit heavy. I don't know. Yeah, that's my question.
Thanks very much, Brian. Let's note that question. The second question, Carol, Brian, let me ask that you put the hand down, so that we know that we are done with that question. I mean, in the event that you want to come back for a second, but we can always do that. Carol, let me invite you to pose your question. Carol, unmute and pose your question, please. Carol, okay. Okay, David Mukoni. David is also gone. Romeo,
I'm still here.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. All right, sweet. Thank you so much for the presentation, first and foremost. So my question is with regards to the wellness portfolio. And what sort of the layout for the groundwork that needs to sort of be undertaken for that, so that, you know, those who are involved, you know, can get involved, so that some of us can get involved in some of the initiatives, so that it can have a much wider spread.
I missed the first part of your question, Romeo. What is the just repeat that.
That's not Romeo.
With regards to the wellness portfolio, because I saw that you guys are going to embark on initiatives to sort of encourage mental health awareness and social cohesion. So I'd like to understand how can we get involved to sort of spread some of those messages within the creative sector.
Hi, Mark. Who was posing the question?
It was David.
Oh, okay. I can't see you here on the list. I'm sorry. Okay, David, noted. Let me get to Romeo. Romeo, your question.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair. I'm sure you forgot to say that there are those who like to make inputs. I think just to acknowledge.
No. Romeo,
yes, Chair.
For now, we're taking questions for clarity.
Okay, no, Chair, I don't have a question because the presentation was very clear and the work is clear. So I would like to make an input.
Okay.
And please don't silence us, Chair. You must give us
Romeo.
Yes.
Romeo.
No, thank you. I'll wait for the time. Thank you.
Zunisani.
Thank you very much, Chair.
You're welcome. Go ahead.
So am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you. That was quite a long presentation. And one of the things that I was actually looking for was talking about more of money, and I think that's what the sector needs. As you can see with other sectors, government is injecting money, not necessarily trying to accommodate certain sectors, but the best way to accommodate them is through money. But my question then is that I was hoping that you would have went more on the national lotteries and the SABC, especially the fact that they're sitting under government. And I was hoping that maybe you would have came up with proposals or even resolutions that it would be much easier for the arts to get a bigger slice of funding as well as exposure. And you only touched on it at the very end with not much detail on it. Can you just give us a bit more detail in terms of the conversations and where is it going in terms of the idea, as well as timeline? In terms of maybe access to more funding from the national lotteries, because already they're giving a large portion to the arts already, but we're not seeing how that is incorporated with arts and culture. So if you can just touch on more of those discussions, as well as the timelines expected to achieve what you talked about with the NLC, with SABC. And then lastly, did you make use of any data analytics in your time spent as a task team? Because a lot of it is just more of, you know, general knowledge. We're not seeing the real numbers in terms of impact in the industry, in terms of monetary wise, how many people were affected. Because it's very difficult then to go negotiate with legislators if you don't have the numbers in front of you. You know, so it would have been nice if you incorporate that. But did you also make use of data and analytics as part of your negotiations? Thank you. Those are my two questions.
Thanks very much, Tunsan. The next question, Riri, please go ahead.
I think that we need a wider communication through SABC radio and TV. A lot of our technicians have had to move back home because they lost their houses. So they're in the rural areas. They don't have access to data or money to buy airtime. So we need to have a concise communication plan through government channels so that we get to those guys so they can also hear what's planning and what's coming. That's the one point. And then where can we get all these docs? Is there a central place we can download the regional documentation that's in the presentation, Sharif?
Okay, I think the question has been noted. Carol had raised her hand, but she's gone. Okay, let me invite.
I'm here.
Carol, okay.
I'm here.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, no, thank you, Chair. I just wanted to ask the very same question that the other gentleman was asking. Regarding the wellness project. So I think it was nearly the very same question.
Okay, no, that's fine. Thanks. Okay. Thanks, colleagues. Okay, let me now request the MAT to respond. Firstly, Rachaina and Sharif, think you will deal with questions that relate to the banking, and I think there was a question from Brian regarding the mandate as well, because he feels that you really it would appear you went quite big, which then obviously touches on the other question regarding the impact of such initiatives. The wellness, obviously, Nozipo and Joy will then speak to Nozipo or Joy will speak to that. Tobela can then come in on issues around the private and corporate sector. Prachina, you'll be first.
Can you reflect? I've been having a lot of questions. Can you reflect the question from Brian regarding what was our mandate?
Yeah, that's exactly the question. What was the founding mandate? Because it would appear that you went
bigger than.
Yeah.
I think where we need to start is that when the MAT was formed or was established, the entire sector were so much under pressure such that we needed to find ways and means of rescuing the situation. It is true what Brian is asking, but you should also remember some of these issues. The fact that there was that development of establishing MAT speaks to the fact that officials within the department either were not capacitated enough or they were not in the position to deal with issues that are affecting us. Now, when we did our own workshop for strategic planning and trying to understand how do we go about dealing with all these work streams, it was very paramount that if you want to get to the root of it, there's no way you can go small. You need to deal with decision makers. And in that case, it forces us to go to the very same institution that Mr. Mkwena is raising. Because I can tell you now, if we never took that approach, we wouldn't have achieved some of the successes that were presented here this evening. So it's a question of trying to deal with the quickest solution one can have in order our sector to be. I'm not sure if I'm able to answer him correctly. Failing which, Sharif can add on. Thank you, sir.
Sharif, please, if you can add.
Thank you, Mpo. So the original mandate came from the sector. It was one of the six work streams, and we put retail and transport together. That's why there were six work streams, terms of reference, that was spoken about in the Freedom Park meeting in January. And based on those terms of reference, which one of them is, like China is saying, challenges with the banking world with regards to loans and higher purchases and what have you, was put on the list for us to engage with. And like China says, unfortunately, the department either didn't have the aptitude or quite honestly just didn't care. This is where MAT stepped up to make sure that we can try and do something for our sector with regards to this. And yes, it hasn't been easy because we are not bankers. I've had to learn overnight, and this is why we've pulled in some specialists to assist us on a way forward. I hope that answers the question. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Let's go to the wellness section. Will it be Nozipo or Joy?
Joy.
Okay, go ahead, Joy.
Okay, thank you, Mpo, CEO and the creatives. Sibonga kuyinyanga yamagugu namasiko. Regarding the question kaButi uDavid, how can the industry be involved in spreading the world? Wellness. As we said,
Joy, we're battling to hear you. If you are able to just remain in one spot for a sec as you answer the question. We're losing you from time to time. Sorry about that.
Okay. Thank you. As Ashilo Uchairperson wethu ukuthi thina ke wellness we are overseeing kune company called Indingilizwe that was given a task by the department ukuthi barane a program ye wellness. What we have seen as well as met is that there was a little involvement of our creatives on the ground. Hence, we made a proposal because if you look at it, we've got a provincial visit. So before provincial visit, there is nothing happening, but there are lines where you can communicate with them. For example, we made proposals, but now we're still waiting for the department to respond because we felt there's a need for our activations in district before the provincial launches. And we felt good there must be our industrial theaters and people to communicate, artists to communicate the program and our radio drama series, our radio jingles, live radio quiz, etc. We focused on radio because of our lockdown regulations. Because wonke our provincial visit were disturbed by our levels COVID. So there is still enough space for the creatives to make our submissions to the department as a program. And there's good number lines where you can contact Abosilapa, a toll free corner, which is 0800-007-088. There's in SMS wellness, there's a website, www.silapa.org.za. There's a WhatsApp number, a corner, 0607097339. But our services are provided by SILAPA. It's financial management, our legal advice, or substance abuse counseling, mental illness. So as a creative, you can tell Uguti there's an opportunity for raising awarenesses on mental illness. I'm aware that the service provider appointed few creatives having a large following on social media to assist in communicating the wellness. My thinking is that what is important in good cinema creatives is to look at the communication and also identifying other creatives in our provinces and organizations who might need these services because they come for free. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much. I want Gabby. I'm sure you heard some of the questions, and I think there was one which was quite detailed. I want you to come in there, to just assist to give some feedback. I will also request Thobela to address that. Eugene, I've noted your hand. I will bring you in. Gabby, go ahead.
Sure. Thank you, Chair. Thanks for the opportunity. I think from my perspective, you know, listening to the questions, etc., I think one also has to be realistic and to be honest about this, that none of these efforts have come without challenges. And one of the challenges, for instance, that we find is in two areas. I can't remember now who posted the question about analytics. Very, very good input. Whoever said that question. And the other one is communication. So in other words, to get the results and the outcomes of what it is that we're trying to drive, to get it to the sector, we've had to rely on internal communications within the department. And I can tell you right now, they are stretched. They are stretched. Obviously, we all know it's not a secret that the ministry and the department have been under a lot of scrutiny and, a lot of confrontation throughout the sector, by the sector itself and from other quarters, and some of it arising from the things that happened, for instance, the ill-fated NAC engagement towards the end of last year, the PSP. So all of the responses from the department involves their communications directly. So that in a sense, we had to share that, and that didn't bode well for us. So we've resolved that going forward, we're going to become quite a bit more independent in terms of interacting with you guys, the sector, a lot more, and getting feedback and getting inputs. Romeo was talking about inputs. I'm hoping he's still going to get an opportunity to bring an input, because it's really important. I mean, this is all about us, and we're just trying to do the best we can for us as a sector. And communication, both communication and analytics, is very much part of it. So we take that input. We need to get more specific empirical information on how many households. If I can just talk briefly about school fees, out of 25,000 schools, roughly, there's about just over 3,000 of them that are public school fee paying schools. And on average, there's between 10 and 50, I know that's a big margin, but per school, that are kids that come directly from creative sector households. So you can make the numbers there. So we've got a bit of analytical feedback there. Of course, we don't have to speak for the non-school fee paying schools. And then of course the private schools, it's parents, you know, option, own choice, if they want to send kids to a private school. But once it falls outside of that, then you're back to work stream one, whether it's banks, lending institutions, etc., to be able to make arrangements with those private schools to, you know, to pay off the debt or whatever the case may be. So that's definitely something that we want to have a look at. The other thing I just wanted to comment on is the fact that, you know, the comment was made that the best response from the state is to put money into sectors. You know, that may be so, but that's not all. That's not the only intervention that can be done. And specifically with a sector like ours, which is underfunded, as we know, yes, we're always campaigning, give us more money, give us more money. We need more money for the sector. And I can tell you that we even said to the portfolio committee that our minister, we know for a fact, has been virtually on his knees to the Treasury for probably the duration of COVID. But essentially, we're going to make them still understand the value of the sector. Once we are more formalized, I also want to encourage individuals to look around you and join the structures that are appropriate to your activity in the creative sector. There are so many diverse structures, labor, there's, you know, in every one of the disciplines, whether it be technical or music or dance or audio visual or crafts or whatever, there is a structure that represents you. And we want to use this opportunity to encourage individuals to go shoulder to shoulder, because as collectives, we have a lot more oomph and power. We can bring a lot more pressure to bear. And then through our communications, you can watch this space. We would like to communicate much more independently. We've already made certain arrangements. And again, we welcome inputs from all of you guys, the sectors. Don't just take pot shots, you know, pot shots. Ah, that's a day. And who do they speak? Please make inputs. We're here. Most of you know us. Please talk to us. Twist our arms or encourage us or criticize us. But please engage with us. Not just take pot shots. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Kevin. Indeed, in fact, they say a bad organization is better than no organization at all. So indeed, belong to structures is very important. Tobela, I would want you to speak to this private and corporate sector, because indeed it is one of the biggest or richest sector in this country, which...
Hi.
Yes.
Thank you. Sorry, just got disturbed. Thank you, colleagues, for the wonderful opportunity you are giving me to speak. With regards to the private sector, one of the things and the challenges that I think, as Sharif has shared, the challenges was the trusting issue and all this mismanagement and all these other things. But the positives that we've managed to, you know, to get out of this, as per Ruzani and Rudy's question, was that one of the meetings that we had with the COO of NLC was very clear that they will want to find a better way of how best they can work with the sector. Because yes, they are giving out money, but they will give out money where people just apply and apply, but they are not even sure if whether that is the money reaching you know, the sector itself. And I strongly believe that that is very critical for us to engage with them, you know, going forward, because we've got our follow-up meeting with the COO and some of the and some of the board members. Regarding the SABC, we engage with it with an idea of saying, how best can we have a cultural and creative industry fund that will assist us in terms of making sure that this dependence on government comes to an end. SABC came back with a positive letter that came from Babu Madoda, Madoda Mkagwa, to say they, as SABC, they are willing to partner with us in terms of making sure that we go out and look for corporate that must come in and put money into that particular fund. And also what they also raised, which was very critical for the creatives, I think really raised that particular part, that, you know, when people want to go and host a concert within M1 Studios and all these things, sometimes it becomes a bit difficult. He has given us a letter of support that says, for those that want to go use M1 Studios throughout the country, because they've got studios all over the country, they are open for such engagements. And for us, it was a big, you know, a plus to say we have SABC on board that is willing to do that. It's just a question of saying we wanted to feedback to the sector so that the sector gets to be aware that there is that particular avenue that has been made available to us to can utilize the M1 Studios to can do other things. And I think also the good thing is that, again, last week we got a call from Standard Bank, who then said, because we had a first meeting with them, so they made a follow-up, you know, call to say they would like us to come back for a second, you know, discussion with our presentation to them to say how best then they can assist us in terms of management of the fund. So we are getting positive results. SAP, as we speak, others might have seen the vaccination rollout plan with the department. SAP is also coming, you know, on board on the vaccination. And I think on the 29th, there will be a meeting between ourselves, Minister and the CEO of SAP, because they reached out yesterday again to say they want that meeting. So there are good things that are coming our way. The unfortunate part is that when we started, it was a bit slow and there was an element of mistrust and the corporate was not easy to say, yes, we want to come in, you know, as easy as that. And also their financial challenges were an issue. So I believe that what Tumsani and Riri asked in terms of that, yes, we have dates that have been put down, but we have not, you know, finalized to say this is what is going to be in the kitty coming from X, Y, and Z. But our net is very wide. We have met more than 30 companies. You know, others are slowly coming back and saying they are considering assisting the creatives. But others are coming up and saying, us as creatives, let's get organized as well. Because we also go as different organizations to these people. We are not coming collective. So they end up not knowing who's who in the zoo and not knowing whether to fund that one or to fund that one. So when we speak as a collective voice, it becomes even much more better for them. So there's a pool of a fund that we can put money in and properly administered for the sector by the sector. That is the direction that we are taking. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Toby. Colleagues, I now want to move to the next part of our engagement, which is, given the presentation that you've had, please let us, Eugene, your hand was down, now you are back. Okay, let me just finish this. I'll recognize you now. I would like, probably after this question by Eugene, to then request colleagues in the room to come up with contributions now, where you feel that this presentation that you have listened to needs to be bolstered, or areas of weakness which you would like to identify, so that the MAT can then note those submissions, and I'm sure they would then find a way of engaging with those suggestions going forward. Eugene, let me recognize your question before we get to, okay, Romeo, you'll be the first in terms of way forward and proposals or suggestions in terms of, going forward. Eugene?
Thanks, Chair. I thought that you had noted me. That's why my hand was down. Thank you very much, Sharif. What a breath of fresh air. I want to commend you guys. I think you have displayed the fact that this sector requires practitioners who are in this sector to deal with its issues, the people who have apparent experiences, and the passion that you're speaking, the way you are speaking, it shows the passion behind what you are doing, that you are not doing it because you are employed, you've got a degree. We don't need academics in this sector. We need people with passion like you do. The first thing that I want to raise is the issue of confidentiality. You see, if it wasn't for Gabriel Leroux, I wouldn't be able to send my details to other people. As you have seen, and you would note that some of the things that are confidential within the department, they ended up in newspapers. Now, how much more with the task team? What mechanism is there to say, if you raise, or maybe let's say, do you have a code of conduct? What are you dealing, how are you dealing with the issue of confidentiality? Because the reason why I'm asking this, you might find that even with the relief funds, it is not artists who are well-known and actors who are well-known who applied for them because they are scared to apply. If I were to apply for for instance, for the school issue, won't I find my name in the newspapers because people that you are working with are not trustworthy when it comes to that? We've seen just recently, the past week, things are going into the media and the screenshots of what is happening behind the scenes. So I'm worried about that. That's the first thing. And I'm saying the communication that must go out there must be able to encourage even somebody like Casper Nyovest, if he's down and out but cannot come out and say, I'm down and out, should be comfortable to raise that issue, those issues with the MATT or whoever the task team is. The second issue is I hear you talking about public schools. I'm happy that we are dealing with people who know the industry, who know this. When we become successful, we take our kids to private schools. Just like I'm sure the minister's kids are also at private school, not at a public school. Now, if I have taken my kids to the public school, come pandemic, it disrupted everything. Am I left outside because my kids are not at the public school? And then the last thing I would like to say, you speak of terms of reference, but I don't know whether you have the code of conduct, because that would be very much important. As I said, that we are dealing with people that we cannot trust. We know that they are very, very loud-mouthed when it comes to issues, gossips, and that they might be taking issues to the media. That's why maybe you're not getting the responses from actual people who have real troubles at the moment, who are losing houses, who are losing cars. You might be getting applications from up-and-coming artists and up-and-coming actors, but not the main one. Thank you very much, Sheikh. But let me commend you, Gabi. Thank you very much for what you did. For me, personally, I wouldn't have done it without you. And Sheriff, I hear such a breath of fresh air when you speak. I think we needed people like you in this sector. Thanks.
Dira! Okay, thanks, Eugene. Gabi, I think the questions relate also to your area. So I'm going to ask you to be the first one to speak. Then the second, let's hear how far you go in responding to the questions that have been raised. I don't know, Sharif, you will also add Let me take you, Gabby, and then Sharif will follow, and then we can then go to Romeo. We need to start wrapping up. Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Chair. Firstly,
Sorry, Chair. When you are answering, please also reference to the POPIA if it does apply in the situation that you are in. Thank you. POPIA Act.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, firstly, just to Eugene, my brother, I'm so happy that you're happy because you know you're a prominent guy and you know from Trompie's side, you guys are such legends and that you know to some extent, people like yourself is a temperature gauge of the condition of the industry. And if you've got some positives to comment and you're happy about something, it really really encourages us because it means. You know that we're obviously doing at least something that's going the right way. So thank you very much for the encouragement, and we truly humbly appreciate that. As far as the points about confidentiality, that absolutely imperative, particularly with the POPI Act, that the inputs and I can refer specifically, for instance, to the wellness sector now, and I'm not digging specifically into that work stream, but. Especially in those areas, and even in school fees, you know, we don't disclose. We are absolutely discreet when it comes to disclosure with regards to personal information, unless such a person asks us. Listen, I would like to make this public as a reference or whatever, but then the they would have to do such in writing so that we at least we covered and we have it coming from them that they wish to make it public. The POPI Act definitely must guide all of us. It must guide society in general. And I'm hoping also that it will be a regulation that guides our media as well. We have to be honest, all of us, that media are able to report and bring information to us responsibly, but they're also able to do a lot of damage. I think there's few of us here, high-profile creative sector people, who have not been nailed by the wrath of a media who perhaps overstepped the line of responsible reporting. And we need the media. I'm not being antagonistic with the media, but I want to appeal to our media colleagues here as well. We've got an industry here that's been at risk and that's been in peril since before apartheid and right throughout apartheid. And many of those things that during apartheid we were suffering from and subjected to is still applying now. Some of them we are even worse off. So we've got so much work to do collectively, and the media has to play a role in that. And issues such as confidentiality, being respectful to each other, rather speak to each other first rather than have public spats between individuals. People, we're distracting from our collective task to fix and to take our industry and our brand to the level that it reaches the actual potential we have, which is international. We want to take this industry with all its mixtures and its unique blends and brands of cultural activity and depth and substance and uniqueness. We want to take it internationally. And that's got the economic benefits. It's got the benefits in terms of creating opportunities for our sector. And ultimately, the economic benefits for us to bring international money and bring it into our industry with well-deserved content that we collectively can do. Confidentiality, sensitivity, mutual respect, all of those things, very much at the heart of this. If you're asking if it is specifically part of our terms of reference, our terms of reference are pretty tight, but Eugene, it's not spelled out that thou shalt comply with the POPI Act, but all of us are responsible people and we will do so anyway, but perhaps it would be a good idea for it to be specifically built into our terms of reference. Just one thing, sorry, if I can just say this as well, I forgot to say it in my previous response to the previous question. The idea of the only way government can provide assistance to sectors is by money, not necessarily. You will see after the latest family address by the president, when he announced that we're going to level two, and already, we haven't got the big stadiums, getting big audiences yet, but at least now we can do 500 people outdoors, we can do 250 indoors, the theatres, the stadiums, much better off from when they only were 50. I mean, imagine an opera house that can take 1,200 or 1,300 people having to sit there with 50 people and try and make it economically viable. It's impossible. With 250, you have a chance already. You can start breaking even. And we're pushing. And this is all stuff that we're doing by want. And I want to thank all of the sectors that worked together with us. We've never seen such unity when we went to NEDLAC. I can assure you guys that. It was an amazing feeling being there with people who normally you would have felt, oh, we don't really get on. And here we are talking together in unity for the sector to reopen this economy rather than just try and throw relief money, sitting at home asking for more relief. Let's get back to work. Finally, touching on a very, very, very sensitive subject, vaccination. We're not sitting here and telling anybody, you must go and vaccinate. You're fully within your rights to vaccinate or not. But the reality is this, it's very, very likely that those who are vaccinated will be able to participate in the reopening of the economy much easier. This is not our regulation. We're not saying you must or you mustn't, but we're telling you the truth. The same as what you walk into a mall and you will not be allowed without a mask, chances are very, very, very strong. But if you want to get back doing gigs, doing performances, doing theater work, doing technical work, roadies, whatever, if you're not vaccinated, you're going to always be at a little bit of a disadvantage to those who are vaccinated. It's don't shoot the messenger, guys, but that's the reality. You can rest assured of that. So for everybody, give it some good thought whether you want to be vaccinated or not. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much, colleagues. Let us quickly now move into these contributions that individual members or organizations or associations may have to this initiative. And be frank, robust, and honest, because it is only out of a robust engagement and an honest one that this initiative will improve and be able to serve the main people whom it is supposed to. Romeo, you are first. Let's try to be concise also. Thanks. Go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Comrade Chair, for not trying to gatekeep us and allowing us. It's not always the case that we'll have questions because we're not always attending programs to criticize, even where there is progress, but we appreciate. So Comrade Chair, I think MET has been a platform that many criticized within the industry when it started without understanding. But from the detailed presentation, it has shown that MET has been working on a daily basis quietly due to the magnitude of the work. So I think that's why we're saying this kind of engagements and briefings are very important. Because you see, many a time people, that's why they end up attacking the ministry, not knowing what is happening. So if we can be able to improve in terms of briefing and trying to get inputs from the sector, you will find that people will understand what is happening behind the scenes. I mean, the involvement of MET alone at NEDLAC, it's one of the biggest achievements, and we should thank the minister for making that possible. Because I can tell you, Comrade Chair, for the longest time during SONA and other programs, you will never hear the president speak more than five lines about the cultural and the creative industry. But we have heard lately that the president has spoken in details about the cultural and the creative industry. Even Didi Mavuza was speaking in details about the cultural and the creative industry. So it shows that those engagements that MET is having with different stakeholders, the banking sector and so on, is making these people to take our industry serious. You spoke of issues of national lottery, you know, so it's true, it's funding a lot of people, but are those people within the sector? You know, so once we have this particular relationship with this institution, it's going to help us to achieve more. We're going to be taken more seriously, and it will be able to contribute a lot. You know, in terms of the artists, so let me thank you, Comrade Gabe, because myself in particular, and Gabe and Leader Beverly, we've been working with those institutions that Sheriff Baker was speaking about, which are dealing with issues of UIF and TERFs. Because of your involvement and the ministry pushing for this particular program with the Department of Small Development, the Department of Employment, Now, as practitioners, we're mentioned in terms of collecting of tariffs and URF and things like that. So it's just that we need to be able to unlock this particular process so that people are able to know that they can be able to get 3,000 or 6,000 for like 6 months, and they can get a payback and stuff like that. So Meg is working on real issues. That's why Leader Brian was also asking that question, because you are not playing games. You know, you are speaking to the captains of the industry. Actually, this is the kind of initiatives that we want, because as the industry, for the longest time, we've been taken as just singers and dancers and benchers. So now at least we can see that through this institution, we're able to be taken serious. And what we need more, Chair, we need money. You know, I know we're raising a lot of issues, but the reality is that people are very frustrated because of lack of access to money. So the issue of money is very important, and government must come on board so that we're able to raise this particular money. So I think my input, Sheriff, is that I heard you mentioning stakeholders within the industry. As Leader Gaby said, people like Eugene are veterans and others. I think we'll let's have diversity in terms of these people who are playing a role in your subcommittees. Let's have youth as well. Let's have women and artists with disabilities in various task teams and initiatives so that we're able to work together. So if you look on the issues that you are raising, like the SABC issue, I know that Bo Eugene have got also a structure that has been meeting with the CEO of the SABC. So I think when she's saying, there are people who are coming, there are things like that which are happening. There are also other structures which are doing their own engagements. So I think as MET, we need to have some sort of a coordination, relationship and partnership so that we don't find ourselves repeating the same things. We find we are supporting each other, because remember, MET is not necessarily an industrial organization. So MET is a ministerial task team, so it must also support programs of the industrial organization. As I finish, Chair, the biggest problem we have, we've been attending meetings of the Department of Small Business Development and the DTI. The reality is that the creative industry doesn't have anything there. I know film has got something that they can't access, which is accessed by international bodies, productions and so on. So I think for MET must strategize and make sure that they push the issue of business, because at the end of the day, we're not just practitioners, we're business people. We want money, Chair. We want our businesses to be worth millions so that we can be able to sustain our industry without government. So I think also the Department of Small Business Development, they're having a lot of opportunities, but they don't have specific opportunities for the cultural and creative industry. So we don't want to just fall anywhere. I think as MET and other institutions, let's fight to have key, like they've got funding for spaza shops. Let's have funding for the cultural and creative industry. That will be very simple and accessible, knowing that our industry is very complex and our people don't have a lot of documentation that are required. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Romeo. Let me invite Eugene.
Thank you, Chair. The first thing that is missing and forever missing, it is the monitoring and evaluation. And I want to propose that MET should look at something like an ombudsman of the sector that will monitor, evaluate, and be able to arbitrate on issues that relate to the industry. And then the second thing is that what doesn't make logical sense to me is when Treasury funds the department, when Treasury gives budget to the department, the department has to disperse the budget to these funding institutions, many different funding institutions. My proposal is that those funding institutions must be collapsed into one funding institution. The reason being, the logical sense would say, if you have seven funding institutions and you have a particular budget, when you disperse that, you are dispersing to seven institutions that have to pay salaries, and you end up with institutions saying or telling the sector that they don't have the budget. The budget is forever missing, because the budget is wasted on salaries, and only to find that the very same institutions are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. We know the experience that we've just had with NAC, and people have been earning. It is the same with different other institutions. People are earning salaries, but they don't provide the services. So collapsing it and and rather sectorizing or giving a particular quota to different sectors and subsectors, meaning that that funding would say for the music sector, this is how much the budget we are giving to it, as opposed to saying NAC, BASA, NEF, when we know that the money doesn't go there. Over and above, they must have also satellite offices all over the country, which means the money that is supposed to go to projects that could change people's lives, it goes to salaries, benefits, when artists don't have those benefits themselves. And then the last thing I want to say that in terms of the task teams, please, I've been saying this everywhere where I gather with any institution, whether it is SAMRO or any, even SAPC, the representation of artists, real artists. We have been unfortunately robbed by people who are saying they're administrators. And administrators don't know the pain that we go through when I have to go and perform and I don't have a place to sleep, I don't have this, and I don't get paid what I'm supposed to be paid. So all they are concerned about it is their commission. I'm not saying that administrators should be kept outside, but I'm saying that we need more representation of real artists in these task teams, in whatever initiative that we're doing. That being displayed by the fact that you guys, you have outdone the department in all what they've done in many years. Even being able to talk to the banks, it means you understand the pain that artists are going through. So that is my request, that in the task teams, don't go with the popularity. I had somebody saying we've asked people who are famous on social media. Social media people are very individualistic. They're only concerned about themselves. They want to have more numbers on social media, as opposed to people who are saying Babu James Mange is sitting there and he's now in hospital. He has no one to look after him. He has no money to pay for his bills. What do we do? They are not concerned about those, the social. So please try by all means. And there is one other thing that we need to be careful about. People who are brought into these initiatives must be screened. There's nothing wrong with one saying, we are going to outsource skills. Audit. Skills audit. Because you don't want to end up with people who are sitting there and earning just to attend meetings when they are not even skilled, they don't even know the issues. That is why I was saying, what a breath of fresh air to listen to somebody who speaks with passion and understanding the depth of what artists are. If it is about artists, if it is about the industry, let's have people who understand the industry and not people who are popular by names. Thank you very much, Chair.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Eugene. Bev, let me recognize you. Debbie, I will come to you. Let me recognize Beth.
Thank you so much, Che. First, I totally agree with Sir Romeo and Comrade Eugene. I want to thank the MAT team for their absolutely remarkable work so far, and I must say a very comprehensive PowerPoint. Thank you, Comrade Gabby and Comrade Sharif Baker, for guiding myself and Sir Romeo. We were in a meeting with Clinton of South African Association for the Conference Industry, and we were in a meeting with the tourism industry with regards to the TERS. I would only like to suggest that Comrade Sharif put us in direct contact with Alan, and I'm specifically referring to his PowerPoint with regards to COIDA and TERS, where he emphasized regarding the collaboration with the South African Events Council and South African Association for the Conference Industry in discussion with the key role players. We would also like to speak directly to the key role players at the Department of Labor, like you've mentioned, Alan. So if you could kindly put us in direct contact. We've managed to register ourselves on the UIF portal. We've managed to register ourselves on the TERS. We would like to go to a further step, so we would really appreciate that. Once again, thank you so much to the MAT team.
Thank you, Bev, for that. Okay, colleagues, I think we have had the contributions that have come from other members here, and I would like us to round up. But as we do so, Gab, I've seen your hand up. I want to just give you a minute or so, and then ask Sheriff to just round up and how you are going to then incorporate these submissions that have been made. Because indeed, it is only out of this type of contributions that MET will be able to achieve what you intended in the first place. Gabby?
Thank you, Chair, and I'll be very short-winded. I just want to pick up on something that Comrade Eugene was talking about. And for those of you who don't like us comrading each other, you know, sometimes that happens as a force of habit. I was comrading the opposition representative at the portfolio committee the other day. It was quite funny, but it was just force of habit. Anyway, people took it very lightly. All right. So with regards to what Eugene was saying about the duplication of costs, we see that right throughout. Let me give you an example. There's a lot of talk now about one society, all rights, for instance. Imagine, instead of having a Samro, a Sampra, a Capasso, an Impra, a this, a that, imagine if all of those were one organization, and that the various organizations, once the way they are now, becomes a business unit or a department within that one society. There's a lot of talk around that. I'm not promoting it at this stage, but I want to put this on the table for you guys to start listening, to start thinking about along those lines, where we cut the costs, where we cut the cost to income ratios, so that every cent of or every rand of revenue that comes in, the international margin for cost to income is about 18%. In Samro, for instance, and I'm just talking about Samro now, we're still sitting close to, I'd say, in the upper 20s, close to 30%, which is not a bad job that they've done since bringing it back from close to 40%. But at the same time, if we didn't have all of those overheads, we could streamline all of our collection societies into a comprehensive one that serviced all the rights from one society. And that's just one aspect. Think of the other thing, for instance, Samro has a very, very successful and a very, very comprehensive retirement annuity fund with a funeral benefit. It's the only society that has that. Now, imagine if all of the societies were included, and even the other creative organizations that covers the actors and the dancers and the audiovisual and the craftspeople, and we all were able to belong to that pension fund. So there will be so many more contributions, the fund will be a lot richer, and the benefits and the premiums will go down. So these are all the benefits. We have to think of it. So the type of work that MET is doing now, we started with these six work streams, but we want to urge all of us, now that we've got kind of a formula where there's not, this is not an organization, it's more like a forum where we can all interact with each other. I support also the point of more regular interaction like this. I think it's Romeo that made that point, where, I don't know, once a month, once every 2 months, we can get together like this. Look at the names attending here today. I mean, there are people here that, you know, many of which you would say, but they're enemies. How can they be in the same? Here we are. Here we are talking. Here we are sitting around the same table. That is the best thing we can do for ourselves, comrades and colleagues, is to think of cutting our costs, pooling our resources, putting our things together, and get more value for the practitioners out of every rand revenue that is available for us to take, and then reinvest to make our industry much more profitable, not only in South Africa by virtue of local content, but to take that local content internationally in all the arts we do and earn money there and bring it back into our economy. So I love that. I love those contributions from Eugene and Romeo and Beverly and all of that. look at where we're going. I mean, we're talking about UIF, we're talking about TERS benefits. That's going to stand us in good stead well beyond COVID. This is future stuff we're talking about. This is legacy stuff, and all of us have a role to play. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Through you, Chair. Chair, just one point. I see here in a comment, there is one very key input from one of our members here who speaks about the issue of database. I think from Evandre saying they should have a database that identify companies within the creative industry, because some of money is going to organizations. So I think the database is key for both companies and organizations, because, like, for example, these programs that are happening, like the one for the awareness and others, which MET and the ministry will be doing, through database, we're able to activate companies and organizations in that area. And also our creatives will be able to participate. I think that is one of the key issues. We have submitted databases to the department, and through MET, I think people are submitting emails. You can also collect more database so that when we have this engagement, we have a complete industry together. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Romeo. Colleagues, I think we have come to the end of our meeting, but
Chair, I forgot to say something through you, Chair. One last thing that is very important. Out of all the things that we have spoken about, yes, we know corruption can deal away with these things so easily. Now, one of the things that MET must do, it is to find a way to discourage and curtail the department being the referee and the player. The department cannot be the regulator and then provide services. That's where corruption kicks in. So we need to deal with that issue. And secondly, the issue of MET.
Mkoni?
Of MET.
Mkoni? Of MET. Just elaborate a bit. What do you mean by the department being a referee and player?
For instance, a department has national events. It cannot be a promoter of those events or the coordinator of those events. There are promoters. China is one of the people that do events. It should give, once we have conceptualized something that we need to deal with, let it be then handed over to the industry to run with it, so that the industry can find itself uniting. If it is promoters, let them come together and do that event together, so that we begin now to work to really, truly, reflecting the unity that we need. You're talking about wellness. There are people who've been running wellness campaigns, wellness programs out there, but the department, it is at the center of the servicing, as a service provider for that, as the manager of that. MET is a task team. That's one thing also that is always missing in the industry. People don't understand that task team, it is formed for a particular task. Yeah. And after that task, that term has ended, the task team is dissolved.
So, yes.
How are you going to deal with that? You must find a way of dealing with that, because it is not only during COVID. These things, they affect artists, period. Thank you, Chair.
All right, thanks. David, I see your hand. Let me be patriotic enough.
Yes, I'm going to be quick. A lot of our creatives have shared the email in the chat. So if we could just please receive the documents and have our own little plan of actions from where we are. Thank you.
Thanks very much, David. Let me then, without wasting further time. Invite the convening chair of MET to just round up, considering all the contributions that have been made. Go ahead, Chair.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, comrades, for affording us the opportunity to present to you. I'm not going to go in full details. I'd just like to take this opportunity to thank you, to thank Mum Jane of Freedom Park of starting this initiative and carrying it through and being with us here today. There is still a lot more work to be done, David, and I'm glad we're giving feedback to the sector And you're 100% right. It cannot be every 6 months. It needs to be once a month or once every 2 months. And this is why our independence is of paramount importance. And this task team, advisory team, still needs to continue post-COVID. And we, if we stand together as a sector, it can do so and it can be so. But communication needs to be a lot greater. And it's something that we plan on doing as we move forward, hopefully with the continuation tenure of the MAT, to continue the work that we have started. I also want to speak and answer Eugene with regards to monitoring and evaluation. We are in the process as MAT with one or two of the other association of putting an ombudsman together, which will speak for the creative industry because there currently isn't one, so that we can have oversight. So I would like you to know that the MAT is definitely working in that regards. And I agree with you. The fact that there is 20 million funding institutions is absolutely sickening, because each one of them gets paid to do the funding, and it takes money out of our pockets. And it's something the MAT has aired and said categorically that we need to make sure there is one funding institution that services the industry with oversight, so what happened at the NAC never, ever, ever happens again, so that us as the African child and the African creative gets to get what is due to us justifiably. So I couldn't agree there more with you. We are in the process of looking at the database, and now that one of the work streams has been able to be freed up, we are definitely going to get involved with that so that we can work further on that. Beverly, I will definitely share with you Alan's number and email address. I think if it's of paramount importance. And then lastly, code of conduct, just to let you know, obviously we are all guided by the Poppy Act, Eugene, and thank you very much for the reminder of it. I just like to guide you and tell you what we do. The minute we go into a meeting, the first thing we do is speak about confidentiality, and that this meeting is confidential, and that you need permission to go out with, because you are 100% right. Unfortunately, there are quite a few people, even in the department, that go out and speak out unnecessarily. And it shouldn't work that way until we can get the work done properly. We are all mature, big people, and we carry on working that way as we have done continuously and still to do so. We are creatives of stature. We are creatives of professionalism, and we will make sure it stays that way. I would, in conclusion, would like to thank each and every one of you and my colleagues from the MAT for affording us the opportunity to present to you today. I will ask the Freedom Park to share this details with me so I can get everybody's email address, so I can share the slideshow with you, and I will definitely do so, and I will try and do so for this evening for everybody. But as convener and chairperson of the MAT, thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for putting us in the position to work with you and for our sector. We will continue to do so so that we can accomplish the goals set out, not just for now for COVID-19, but for our future. On behalf of the MAT, thank you.
Colleagues, thank you very much. May I just thank you on behalf of Freedom Park for having participated. From here, we know that you are going to brief, obviously, the minister. A report of this meeting would have to be compiled and submitted to the department or to the minister. And we would like to really just once again re-emphasize the importance of dialogue and communication. And we hope that, Matt, you will indeed look into that aspect of communication, how you ensure that the majority of practitioners, the majority of artists feel that you are a platform that they can rely on, because indeed this one man show or one woman show does not help the industry much. It is indeed our pride as Freedom Park to be associated with this initiative, which we have come to this point or level. So colleagues, thank you very much, and we will look forward to the next engagement Met team, please make sure that we are indeed addressed and invited to those forums, so that if there are any contributions that members can make or practitioners can make, those can be done at this time. Thank you very much, and this meeting is adjourned.
Bye, everyone. Thanks very much. Much love and respect.
Hello. They said they called from the CEO's office. They said they switched the phone. I haven't checked. I can't see the meeting. They called us in Khalakha home, like 30 minutes or so.
It's fine now.
What away with it, okay.
I don't know, they said they're gonna investigate.
People just like noise, me.
I ended up thinking, let me just call the offices, not call centers anymore. Let me call this gate, it's closed.
Okay. But the hospitality industry suffered. The tourism industry. And what schedules lockdown. It's tough.
Hectic. You can think how many people lost jobs there. Including cleaners.
True.
Why is it logical escape?
I don't know, but you know it's not the more like it.
Thank you. Yeah, like this.
Good question. Very good question. What's your plan?
Okay. Alright, Keith.
Thank you. where power and students are almost in the course of the setting. All these members have to do with it on 2 or 3 months, and the big is that people who are trying to do their work, their design. And they walk around, making themselves as if they are ready to act. And as I was saying, probably a very good thing. Now,
Thank you. But some of the people who are in the class, and sad and not so kind of